You're listening to Drinks and a Movie with your host, Rudy. Spoiler alert.
Well, Drinks and a Movie podcast. Everybody, I got a brand new episode here. We're going to be talking about the career of Carlos Avila, my special guest. Carlos, thanks for joining me.
Thanks for having me. Yeah, I'm looking forward to this.
Great director, films like Price of Glory. You've got a new short film out called The Kill Floor that's doing the festival run. You've done a lot of TV such as Grimm and Cold Case, and we're just going to talk about directing, and I'm super stoked to have you here. You know, we were talking, we've been trying to get this going for a year.
Yeah.
So it's nice to have you, man. Thanks for being here.
I appreciate your diligence, your persistence. It's great. It's great to be here.
And let's see for this. So you've got a Paloma that I made. Hopefully it's good.
Yeah, it's excellent, man.
I made that one with La Gritona, which I've talked about on the show before. I should have kept the bottle up here, but it's an all-female run company. Wow. Great, nice, like green bottle. I think it came out maybe 2016 or so, if I remember correctly, but it's a really good one. So anyone who hasn't tried that, La Gritona, that's a good option. I'm going to be sipping on Mezcal 33, which we featured on the podcast recently. If you haven't seen that episode, I have the brand ambassador James Humphrey on it. So that was an episode from a couple weeks ago. And yeah, this is great. This is the Hoven. They've also got a Reposado in a nice black bottle. And we paired it with chocolates, and it was awesome. So I'm slowly getting a little more into the Mezcal thing.
I might need to get a hit of that before I leave.
Yeah, let me know. That's right. But all right, Carlos. So let's talk movies. So you were kind enough to show me your thesis film from UCLA when you were over there. I'm curious, just how did you begin your filmmaking journey? Did you know from childhood that getting into movies is what you wanted to do? And like, what put you on that path?
Didn't even consider it. You know, it was something that came much later. I think initially, I mean, I always had creative instincts. You know, the big creative endeavor that I did when I was in high school was I was in a rock and roll band, you know, a garage band. And, you know, we did Led Zeppelin and Rolling Stone covers. And so when I got to Loyola Marymount, which is where I got my undergrad degree, I was thinking I was going to get into sound recording, you know, sort of an extension of that music work that I had done. And one aspect of the curriculum was to make a short film. And so we made our Super 8 films. That was very exciting to me. And then we did our short film, and that was, you know, like a 5-minute film that was very well received. You know, and I had some great professors that encouraged me to keep going. And so I applied to UCLA, got into the graduate film school. As you get towards the end of your time there, you're asked to make a thesis film. And I knew about this situation in Los Angeles about segregated swimming pools that were happening around 1943, very, very close in time to the Zoot Suit riots, you know, and Zoot Suit, the movie and the play, were something that really influenced me and impacted me. I was an usher at the Music Center when that was happening, and got to see that show many, many times. And then I thought it was kind of interesting that for a kid growing up during that time, you know, in Distant Water, the main character is 10 years old, and how he would see what manifestation that level of racism that was happening in Los Angeles would take. And I thought that the fact that swimming pools were segregated in Los Angeles during that time, you know, they would only allow Latino kids to go swimming on Wednesdays. And that was the day before they cleaned out the swimming pools. And so I thought, well, okay, well, that's an arena that a kid would experience racism. And so I created this story. Two things are happening. The father's experience is the Zoot Suit riots, the race riots. And in the kid's world, it's what's happening with the segregated swimming pools. And at the end, the two things meet up. You know, and there's parallels to The Kill Floor. You know, as I was writing The Kill Floor, I unconsciously felt like there was some parallels. Mm-hmm. But Distant Water was you know, a great experience. It was wildly ambitious for a graduate student budget, 1943 period film.
Yeah, yeah.
Was, you know, kind of a ridiculous undertaking. But we did it, you know, me and my scrappy team of fellow graduate students, you know, we figured out a way to tell that story. There was enough locations that we had easy access to that we were able to use. We had access to a swimming pool in El Sereno. And so that was, you know, quite remarkable that they let us shoot there on a student film budget. And we had a beautiful cast, as you saw. You know, Jeff Rivas was in it.
Yeah,
Enrique Castillo, Kiki Castillo was in the film. Mm-hmm. His wife, Belle Hernandez, she's in the film. And so, so that was really wonderful. We ended up taking the film to Japan. And it was a festival of international film students. And, you know, much to my amazement, it won the grand prize there. And the grand prize was $175,000 to make another film.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, I took that money and, you know, I had a rough outline of a second film that I was going to do. And one of the catches of that prize money, that $175,000 prize, was that you had to turn a film around in a year. And so you had to, the following year, you had to premiere your film. And so I took that money, I took it to PBS. There was a great series called American Playhouse, and they were doing original films. Films like Stand and Deliver, The Ballad of Gregorio Cortez, El Norte, all went through and got some funding from American Playhouse. So my instinct was, okay, well, I'm going to ask them, see if we can get some more money from them. They came on board, they doubled our budget, and we were able to shoot it. And it was a one-hour drama called La Carpa. It eventually played on PBS. We premiered it. We screened it at Sundance. It premiered in Tokyo. But we did play it at Sundance. I think it had its American premiere here at Sundance. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that got the ball rolling. That started my relationship with PBS, which I've had, you know, in addition to the commercial work that I do, I've had the good fortune to be able to go back to PBS and do a documentary or do a short film. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it was distant water. They got the ball rolling on that stuff.
Yeah. Well, that's crazy. You almost make it sound kind of easy, but I know it wasn't.
Yeah,
right?
You know, you're wildly ambitious.
Yeah.
You know, you think, you know, the film that I did, La Carpa, which was the film that I made with the prize money, that was also a period film. That was 1938, and we ended up shooting it out in Guasti when Guasti was still relatively untouched, and I hired all my film school friends, you know, and mm-hmm. so. You know, a lot of people say, you know, you don't necessarily need to go to film school. But, you know, for me, it was a great thing because I could meet a whole group of people that I could put to work right away. And, you know, so it was, you know, the film school experience was great. Being able to come out of school right away and make another film. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that's a real tough thing for people. You know, I think a lot of people get out of film school and they get lost.
Yeah.
They start doing other things. You know, fortunately, I was kind of propelled to do another film. And that started the ball rolling.
Yeah. Man, no, that's great. It's a good thing it worked out that way. And I mean, how when you did that piece, Distant Water, I mean, one thing that really stood out to me, and as you mentioned, was the period aspect of it. And I felt like I was really trying to gain a lot from that because I actually have an idea that I want to do soon that is period piece. So I'm like, all right, how did you pull that off? I mean, was the choice in, I mean, obviously film was the thing at that time, but like black and white and everything, was that kind of an aesthetic choice to help, you know, hide certain things and sell the period aspect of it?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and my references, you know, I've always found putting together, you know, it's a common tool, but putting together visual references, right? Mm-hmm. Most of them were in black and white.
Yeah.
And so this movie needs to be in black and white. And it did. I mean, you know, we were able to cheat a lot of stuff because it was in black and white. We were able to sell the period, you know, the... you know, the world looks different in 1991 when we made that, you know, than it did in 1943. And so it was a shorthand that I think we used successfully.
Yeah. And I have to watch it again. But when I see it, I mean, you do a good job and just like the way everything is framed, you just never I buy it the whole time that it's in this time period.
I'm real excited because a film programmer in San Antonio reached out to me recently, and there's a civil rights organization that is going to screen the film at a swim party. You know, so for a lot of Chicano kids, the Mexican American kids, they're going to show the film while they're having the swim party, and so that'll be this summer in San Antonio. And so I'm really excited that the film still has some interest.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I look at it and I see the work of a young guy. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not as visually kinetic as, you know, my instincts would be now.
Yeah.
But I think the simplicity of the storytelling really works well with the subject matter. And the fact that it's still, people talk about it, people still ask me about it. I recently had it restored, which I'm excited about. We did a big restoration at Photochem, and hopefully we can get it archived soon.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow, that's awesome. It's a good thing you still had all your raw materials.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because it seems like it would be really easy, especially in that era for, you know, like physical films to kind of get lost in prints and all of that.
I still have the negative. Yeah. The thing that I did lose was the mag track. I have the optical track, but I don't have the mag track. But it's still, when we did the restoration, I think they did a nice job cleaning up the audio. So it still sounds pretty good.
I mean, another ambitious side of it is the fact that you have like a largely child cast. And then with you being, you know, young in your directing career, you're still a student at this point. I mean, what were the challenges dealing with the kids?
We had great parents, you know, and so, you know, we kind of pushed the limits of, you know, the SAG rules in terms of having the kids out.
Yeah.
But we had great parents that were very supportive in terms of performance. I think, you know, it was three kids primarily, right? Mm-hmm. And Leonard Camarilla, who I still keep in touch with.
Nice.
And there's another young guy who plays the bully on the other side. I keep in touch with him, and he's a wonderful musician. Leonard has worked in restaurants. This other guy, Blaine Campbell, he's got a recording career. So I'm really proud to still know these young guys and see what they've done with their lives. It's one of the unusual parts of this business that I never anticipated. Mm-hmm. But I think most of the kids had some experience. And so, you know, I was able to, you know, I've certainly gotten better working with actors. And, you know, in The Kill Floor, we have a young boy who's in it, and he's phenomenal. But I think I was able to get them to tap into the circumstances that the kids were in, and there was some empathy that they embraced with the characters, their situation. And then they were just kids, you know. Some of the scenes were just written so that they're just kids making fun of each other, kids having a good time. We had the added benefit of there being scenes in a swimming pool. Mm-hmm. And so that bonded them quite a bit. You know, they could play around in the water.
Yeah.
And they became friendly with each other. And so I think that registers on screen. Mm-hmm. But the fact that they'd had a little bit of acting beforehand, I was the beneficiary of that. That helped a lot.
I mean, I have to ask at that point, because we're talking, what, like late 80s, early 90s UCLA, right?
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, were there a lot of other Latinos there in the film program, or were you kind of the outlier there? I'm just curious at that time.
You know, I mean, I went to UCLA because it had a tradition of independent filmmakers, right? One of the people that I really admired was Greg Nava, Greg had gone to school there. And one of the professors at Loyola Marymount that encouraged me knew Greg. And so eventually, you know, we were able to get, in fact, Greg, I still have it. Greg Nava wrote my letter of recommendation for UCLA.
Oh, really?
Well, and so, so that was very nice. And so I had that in my head. I go, you know, it was at a time when independent film was really blowing up. People like Spike Lee, John Sayles, Steven Soderbergh. And so to know that that was something that was relatively close to where I lived and I could go and perhaps be a part of that tradition.
Yeah.
And then I was a big fan of Francis Coppola, and he'd also gone to UCLA. And so I go, that's where I'm going to go. And it was nice because, you know, I'd gone to a Catholic high school and I'd gone to a Catholic university. And then to go to UCLA, where it's people from all over the world.
Right, right.
People from the Middle East, you know, people from the East Coast. It was such a great and exhilarating place to be. You know, there's people who, you know, were part of that filmmaking tradition, the L.A. Rebellion. You know, Billy Woodbury was there. You know, black filmmakers that really made an impact. Mm-hmm. They were around. You know, and so it was great to be in that world. You know, as far as other Latinos, there were a couple of other people that, you know, were there. You know, it's, you get so immersed in your group of friends that, you know, fortunately, I lost track of that because I felt embraced by this new group of friends, new group of filmmakers. I remember Fernando Sariñana, who had come from Mexico, and he's had a very prominent directing career in Mexico. He came, he studied at UCLA, and he went back to Mexico. So there were people like that. Mm-hmm. Alexander Payne was there. Alexander Payne was the year before I was. He was a year ahead of me. But we had the great pleasure and experience of all being in an editing class. There was an effort to try to professionalize the film school. And so they brought in some professionals from the film industry. And so one of my mentors, one of the people that means the most to me, two people actually, Richard Marks and Barbara Marks. And Richard Marks was the editor of, he was co-editor of Apocalypse Now, co-editor of Godfather Part II, edited a bunch of films for James Brooks. And he came in and he was our editing teacher. And he was still working at the same time. And his wife, who had worked as a sound editor, Barbara Marks, she came in and she was also part of that that editing class. And so is Alexander Payne, people like Pamela Tom, Margot Newman, you know, all these people who have had careers were all in that editing class. And so I was working on Distant Water, you know, while I was in their editing class. You know, it was a great experience, you know, just to be among all those people who had that independent spirit, you know, that desire to make independent film. And, you know, they became my family. And I keep in touch with so many of them still. You know, they're people that I call on, people that I lean on. It's quite beautiful. Zainabu Davis, who has a short film that's doing the rounds right now as well. She has had you know, some wonderful films that she's made. She came to the premiere of The Kill Floor in San Diego. And then the UCLA Archive had a retrospective of her work as well. Mm-hmm. So I went to that. So, you know, we're all still rooting for each other.
At this point, I'm just curious, what were your, influences? Like, I know you named some filmmakers that were coming up at that time, but what were you into watching and what was inspiring you?
I think like a lot of people, you know, who grew up in L.A., Zoot Suit for me was a really big deal. And so I was fortunate because I was an usher at the Music Center. And you know, I saw the various incarnations of that. I saw Luis Valdez around. You know, I saw Eddie Olmos. I saw Daniel Valdez. Rose Portillo, Lupe Ontiveros, God bless her, they were around. And they created this phenomenon that, I mean, it shook the earth here in L.A. And so it was great to witness all that. And it told me that there was an audience for Latino stories. It told me that you could tell a Latino story in a really inventive way. Mm-hmm. And so that was very inspiring to me. And then Greg Nava's movie, El Norte.
Yeah.
You know, that was really important to me. You know, and I think I've had the opportunity to tell him a few times, you know, how much that movie meant to me. You know, that was made independently, yeah. You know, and because it had PBS money, you know, I was sort of feeling empowered, because when I started doing my PBS work, that was, you know, I felt like I was going down the same road. So El Norte, Zoot Suit, and, you know, the Ballad of Gregorio Cortez, you know, I think those three movies really, you know, meant a lot to me. Zoot Suit, of course, was a play, and then it became a movie.
Yeah.
But those things showed me that you could tell a Latino story in a very creative way. And the revelation was, you know, and it shouldn't have been a revelation, but so many of our Latino actors are underutilized, but to see them in prominent roles and to carry the day and to give us memorable performances that are riveting and unforgettable, you know, it made me want to keep working in that tradition. You know, I've tried to do both things, right? Do the commercial work,
yeah,
you know, because you have to make a living, but then also to do the independent work. And I find that my touchstone is always going back and, you know, trying to do a documentary or trying to do a short film that takes me back to my roots of wanting to tell, you know, Latino stories that work within the things that inspired me when I was starting.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's those movies definitely tie into that kind of indie filmmaking spirit too. Like El Norte, it's funny, we just did released an episode on that just a couple weeks ago. Finally. Oh, yeah.
Who did you have?
It was just a friend of mine.
Okay.
Because I would love to get Gregory Nava.
Yeah.
That's someday I'll manifest
it. Yeah. But, yeah.
I mean, that movie's a masterpiece.
Yeah.
And Gregorio Cortez, just that other very raw, that 16 millimeter look, a lot of natural light.
Super 16, Reynaldo Villalobos, you know, it was unbelievable.
And, and then Zoot Suit with it, just like the vibrancy, the color, the kind of film, but yet staged theatrical kind of vibe.
And I'm glad that exists, you know, I'm so glad because, you know, seeing it. And like I said, I was working there as an usher, so I got to see it over and over again. And then it moved over to the Aquarius Theater, and then I went to go see it just as an audience member, not as an employee of the theater, just because I was so moved by it. And it was a different cast. By that point, Enrique Castillo was playing Henry Reyna.
Okay.
And I think Marco Rodriguez was playing the El Pachuco role, you know, because the original cast was in New York doing it on Broadway.
Yeah.
You know, so it was great to see that even with a different cast, it still had the power that it had when I originally saw it.
And then from this point, I mean, now, you know, you've made your thesis film, you got money from Japan, or you showed it in Japan, you got funding for your next project. I mean, where does your career go from here? I know that soon after this, you did Foto Novelas.
Foto Novelas, yeah.
And then, so was that the very next kind of big project? And how did that come to be?
So it's funny because Distant Water started the ball rolling on Price of Glory.
Okay.
But simultaneously, I had the opportunity to pitch some series ideas to, once again, to PBS. And it was actually an entity that exists within PBS called ITVS, Independent Television Service. And at the time, they were new. They had, you know, the resources to support, you know, quite a few independent filmmakers. And so I pitched them this idea of a Latino Twilight Zone. And so that's what Foto Novelas was.
Oh, wait, sorry. So that was your brainchild?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So I created the concept for the series.
Yeah.
And it, the original idea, because I remember growing up and seeing those Mexican comic books, the real thick ones, the historietas, and the, you know, some of them are like photo photographs with text. And those are called the foto novelas. But then the graphic novels, I mean, the big, thick graphic novels, those are historietas. And so I proposed this idea that we would tell Latino stories that had an otherworldly dimension, you know, supernatural, science fiction, magical realism, fantasy, and to have a social theme woven in, because I think that's, you know, something that appeals to me, all obviously, but then additionally something that I felt would resonate for PBS, you know, something that they could put on the air. And so so I pitched that to them. We ended up doing 6 half-hour dramas. The first set of 4 we did, and I was so honored because they premiered the show. You know, they have a series called American Masters, and they showcase some, you know, great historic creative figure in American culture. And so they premiered the first episode of Foto Novelas the same night that they premiered the American Masters episode on, of Rod Serling. So, you know, the creator of Twilight Zone. And then right after that finished, my episode of Foto Novelas came on. So I was just so blown away. I was so excited that that happened. You know, we did, originally we did 4, and then like I think a year later we did another couple of them. There were supposed to be another 4, but you know, that was around the time that 9/11 happened, and so suddenly there wasn't any money, but there was enough money to do 2,
right?
And those we shot in San Antonio.
Sorry everybody, we got a ice machine going on, so if you hear this background noise, that's the perks of shooting in a bar. You get a beautiful location, but there's some stuff you just got to deal with. So it's a double-edged sword.
That's great.
It's better than a plain white room, that's for sure.
That's right. So you were asking me about Foto Novelas.
Yeah. So time Foto Novelas. Sorry, one quick sure. question here on it. Did you direct all of the episodes that you did, or did you?
Well, you know, again, one of the things that I continually find, you know, my wife has reminded me of this, but. You know, generating your own opportunities is super important and super essential if you're going to survive any length of time in doing what we do. And so of the 6 episodes that we did, I directed 5 of them. And I was supposed to direct the other one, but producing and directing and writing, it got a little overwhelming. And so I had another gentleman, AP Gonzalez, direct one of the episodes, but I directed 5 of the 6, and that was incredible. I mean, you know, talk about film school, you know, and to work in different genres, because as I said, science fiction, fantasy, magical realism. So it was wonderful to be able to do that. You know, I guess about 10 years ago, the Museum of Radio and Television archived the Foto Novelas, and so they're in their permanent collection in New York.
Awesome.
So that's really awesome.
And then we were talking a little bit, I mean, I might just keep that section, but just in case you know, I don't, you were talking a little bit about how there's an episode in there that kind of helped propel you into getting Price of Glory later, and there's an actor in there that you've worked with on a few of your projects now.
So one of the episodes was called The Fix, and it was written by Bennett Cohen and Edith Villarreal. And it's, you know, about a boxer that's, you know, down on his luck. He suffers an injury. And so if he fights again, he's going to risk his life, but he wants to do it anyway. And so for that episode, we had this wonderful actor, J.R. Yenke. I know him as Jose Yenke, but he's going by J.R. Yenke now. And so there's an couple of extended boxing sequences in the film. And so it was wonderful to be able to have an example that I could direct boxing in action to show New Line Cinema, who eventually produced and released Price of Glory. So it was my showreel for them.
Yeah.
In addition to serving the purpose of being a part of that series.
I mean, I guess that's a great segue into Price of Glory.
When his career ended, theirs was just beginning.
With the boxing, there's something that I know I can give them there. I can teach them.
Now, a father with a dream has three chances to keep it alive.
I'm going to be the one that takes this family to another place.
They're punching guys into other time zones.
I give you $100,000 for Sonny and Jimmy's contract. Throw in Johnny, I'll double the amount.
No deal.
You think you're going to manage them all the way to a title? That ain't going to happen.
We'll see.
You got to try. I'm not the one in the ring. You're the one in the ring.
You can't control everything they do.
Well, I'm their manager.
No, Arturo, you're their father.
You could have a title shot right now.
You want to go run to somebody else? You go ahead.
It'd be easier with Everson.
Who got you there?
We got deals your father can't make.
A title shot at Davy Lane for $500,000.
You figure I'm just like my brothers. You weighed those dollar bills, and that rolled over, right?
You did the best that you could.
I don't know if I have.
You do what you need to do.
Need to talk to you different, not like your fighter, like your son.
I did what I know how to do so that you and your brothers could maybe have something that I never could have.
I don't really see a champion in you.
Well, maybe you ain't looking hard enough.
And I got to talk a little bit about this because this is the movie that inspired me to track you down and reach out to you through social media. Was when I started the podcast. I mean, I cover all kinds of movies and genres, but anyone who's been following along from the beginning knows that getting like Latino movies and Latino filmmakers is like a really big part of it for me.
Yeah.
You know, I grew up with a lot of great films that I want to share with different people. Price of Glory being one of them. And I remember my parents, like, I remember singing in theaters with my parents. So I'm 33.
Yeah.
That movie came out in 2000, I think. Yeah. So I was pretty young. I remember them taking me to see it.
Wow.
You know, we had the DVD and everything. And then I ordered the DVD a couple years ago when I started the podcast. I was like, I got to revisit this, watch it. So again, it's kind of crazy. Like now talking about it out loud, it's dawning on me. I'm like, wow, like you're here. We're doing it. This is great. Like I was watching it the other day. And you're the guy. So now you've done your TV series, your short films, Price of Glory, kind of the next tier, right? New Line Cinema, right? Feature film. And you've got some vets on your cast here, Jimmy Smits.
Yeah.
You know, Sal Lopez.
Yeah.
I'm sorry for all the other names that are going to slip.
You've even Ron got Perlman. Ron Perlman. John Sada. Yeah. Clifton Collins Jr.
Yeah.
You've
even got Ruth Carter doing the costumes.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, from Spike Lee's films.
Right.
I guess a couple of questions right now is, one, you talked a little bit about this, but how did you get to that point of being in the running to get that film as a director? Because you didn't write it, if I remember correctly, right? So you directed it, and what was I going to say? I guess let's start there. Like, how'd you get into that?
Well, so Distant Water got some publicity, right? Mm-hmm. It was written about in the LA Times. And there was a production company called Shoreline Pictures. And they're still active. And I keep in touch with Morris Ruskin, who was one of the producers on the film and one of the principals at Shoreline Pictures. And I think they had seen, someone in their camp had seen Distant Water. And at the time I came on board, Price of Glory was called The Ortegas.
Okay.
And it was a stage play that had been written by a gentleman named Phil Berger. And Phil was the boxing columnist for the New York Times, prolific writer of sports, you know, certainly newspaper articles, but also sports books. And he had been inspired, you know, by the story of the Ayala family in San Antonio, Texas.
Okay.
You know, very ultimately tragic story of what happened there. But he fictionalized quite a bit and came up with a stage play called The Ortegas. And so they came, they got a hold of me. I came in and they asked me if I responded to the material. You know, I loved it. The one thing that I will say is that Phil was a journalist before he was a drama writer. So we actually did the adaptation together.
Okay.
And so we went through various drafts of the script together. At times, you know, very closely working together. At times I would give Phil notes. Shoreline was involved in the development of the project. We went to the screenwriter's lab and the director's lab at Sundance with the project. And it was a long, it took a long time. You know, so I was doing Foto Novelas at the same time,
okay.
Trying to get, make some headway with Price of Glory. And eventually, I think Shoreline remained a part of it, but then Esparza Katz, Moctezuma Esparza's company, they got involved as well. And the whole package went to New Line eventually. And it became what started as a movie that was going to be made for $500,000 ended up being a $12 million film.
Wow.
And so that was my first feature.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it was a mental adjustment, you know, to walk, to drive up to base camp and see all the trucks and to, you know, where I was used to, you know, someone's pickup truck having all the gear. You know, there was trucks and there was, you know, trailers. There was, you know, all the chingadera that, you know, that's a part of making a movie.
Yeah. You're not over there wrapping cables.
Absolutely. You know, so it's, you know, there was that mental adjustment. Yeah. The other thing that I will say, and something that, you know, by necessity and by desire you get better at is collaborating with people.
Yeah.
You know, because suddenly I was in a situation where I was working with producers and they had a point of view. And, you know, so you're trying to figure out how to maintain what it is that you want to say through the story and still having to negotiate the point of view of all these people who have a right to make a contribution. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you're selling your point of view, you're selling your instincts, you know, you have a vision for the material and you want that to get out there. That's why they hired you.
So now you're collaborating, you know, you got producers, you got all these people in the mix. I mean, I guess in the biggest budget you've worked with so far, you know, feature film.
Exactly.
What were... I mean, did you have to deal a lot with different producer views? I mean, I guess I'll start there and we can talk like about actors and all that, but do they mostly kind of let you do your thing, or because you were new at the feature level and with this budget, you know, were they kind of in your head a lot?
You know, my experience on Price of Glory was, you know, adapting to, you know, working with creative partners, right? Where I'd done my independent projects. And, you know, I was pretty much calling the shots, you know, and that, you know, if you're a responsible filmmaker, if you make your days, you know, if you stay within budget, then that works out pretty well. You know, when you come into a situation where people are putting $12 million on the table and they're going to want to say in what, you know, what the end product's going to look like, you know, and so, you know, negotiating with them, you know, I mean, the great thing is that everybody wanted the film to succeed. Mm-hmm. Jimmy Smits was an incredible partner. The cast was really on my side, you know. You know, I think everybody was working in the same direction. But, you know, there was that, you know, that, just getting, you know, getting acclimated to having other people, you know, weigh in on things. You know, certainly in the editing, you know, certainly in terms of the score, in terms of the music that we, you know, one of the great, great things. One of the things I'm the most proud of in regard to the film. I mean, I love the film. I'm very proud of it. I think there's aspects of it that never quite transcended the fact that the source material was written for the theater. But the soundtrack, you know, with all those rock and Espanol bands, yeah, you know, with Latino hip hop, I think only at that point Star Maps, Miguel Arteta's movie, had really showcased Latino rock, mm-hmm, in that way. And so for us to be able to do it, you know, and to get a, you know, I mean, a lot of people consider that CD that came out, you know, a classic, yeah, because it really popularized that music and got it out to a very wide audience. So I'm very proud of that. But, you know, there was, you know, you have to get acclimated, right?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
And that was very useful when I started direct television, which is extremely collaborative. You know, they hire you for your point of view, for your, you know, skills as a storyteller, but you're working within somebody else's house.
Right.
And so
right,
you have to adapt to that as well. So Price of Glory prepared me for that.
Mm. Now, in terms of directing, I imagine there was a lot of lessons to learn from dealing with this cast. Did you have to change your approach with certain actors? And I mean, was there anybody that kind of maybe butted heads with you in any way? And I mean, I guess, what is your approach even to begin with when it comes to directing and working with actors?
You know, I left that experience, you know, with Price of Glory. I mean, like I said, I mean, you know, Jimmy Smits is an extremely generous actor, you know, with the other cast. You know, that was another situation where we had a young cast, right? You know, so the first 20 minutes of the movie, it's the boys,
right,
you know, the kid versions of who John Seda, Clifton Collins, and Ernesto Hernandez become. Mm-hmm. And so Jimmy was great with those kids. I mean, some of those scenes are some of my favorites,
yeah,
where he's interacting with the little kids. Mm-hmm. You know, I will say that I left the experience, and I'm speaking very candidly, but I left that experience knowing that I wanted to get better in terms of being able to express myself to actors.
Yeah.
And so I did. I mean, I went on this whole journey. I studied with Judith Weston.
I'm reading her book now.
She's
an
incredible lady.
Yeah.
Incredible lady. I took a couple of workshops with her. We keep in touch.
Nice.
Recently, maybe about 3-4 years ago, there's another phenomenal teacher in town, Elizabeth Messnick, and I sat in on her workshops. And so I just really wanted to become a better director of actors. And I think I've gotten to that point where I feel like I could communicate within the vocabulary of an actor.
Yeah.
Something that they understand. When we did The Kill Floor, we didn't have a lot of rehearsal time, but I insisted that we have some rehearsal time. Mm-hmm. And so Miguel Najera and Jaime Zevallos, who play the father and son, I said, these two actors I need to work with.
Yeah.
And so we had a rehearsal time. You know, I love improvs, you know, not necessarily in front of the camera, but in the rehearsal process. And so we did some of that. We also read through the scenes. But I feel that Price of Glory put me on that path to say, you know, okay, I want to learn how to speak to actors in a way that's effective, in a way that resonates with them, that inspires them, that helps them elevate their performance. You know, we're very fortunate in that we have a tremendous pool of Latino actors. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of really good people, and they'll make you as a director look good if you tap into, you know, that great resource. But I've also made it a point of, you know, really preparing, you know, I mean, I really prepare the scenes.
Yeah.
And so that, you know, I know that even if it's just whispering a word into their ear, that will resonate with them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's important. And I feel like Price of Glory, that was one of the gifts of Price of Glory, is to inspire me to go down that path of becoming a better director of actors.
And was it tough for you to, I mean, maybe not, because you said that you worked with the writer in kind of adapting it to film. So I imagine at that point, maybe it wasn't too hard to, you know, take a script that you didn't necessarily write or have any part in initially, but then have to, you know, direct these performances I mean, is that difficult at all? Because maybe not in this movie, since you did work with the adaptation, but then even in your television work, you know, is that kind of hard to do? Or
I think the challenge for a television director is to find a way into the material, right? Mm-hmm. You know, so I've been very blessed, I think, in terms of the work that I've done, is that, you know, I do have an affinity for the episodes that I've been able to do. Mm-hmm. In the case of the cold case episode that I directed, you know, that was really good subject matter. You know, it was, it had social justice aspects of it that, you know, I am continually interested in.
Yeah.
And so I could embrace that. With Grimm, you know, even though that had fantasy aspects to it, you know, I had worked in supernatural with the Foto Novelas, right? You know, and so I had an affinity for that otherworldly subject matter. The second episode of Grimm that I did was a Latino story. The main character was this Latino that would transform into a monster with three arms and three eyes. And and so, you know, so I got to work with a wonderful actor, Carlos Sanz. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so that was great. That felt like the old days, you know, working with a Latino actor. Mm-hmm. And that was my primary collaborator. So I think, you know that if you're working in episodic television, that you're going to have to find a way into the material and make it your own and try to find a way to make it personal. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, so that comes with the territory. But, you know, I've been fortunate that I've been able to direct things that I've written. Mm-hmm. But I think if I'm doing, a project, the thing that's going to carry you and inspire you and give you the passion to make it through is connecting with it and having a passion for it. And so however you do that, you know, that's going to be your saving grace.
When you did Cold Case, so you had Chadwick Boseman in that episode, right?
Yeah.
So now, I mean, getting into the TV thing, you're working with like another bigger, like array of actors. It's funny. I was actually watching that episode of Grimm earlier that you had mentioned.
Yeah.
And, Silas Weir Mitchell, who was in it.
Yeah.
I actually worked on a short film. I DP'd a short film with him about a year ago.
Really?
So I was like, oh, cool. Yeah. I know this guy.
Yeah.
And then,
such a creative guy.
Yeah. And we even talked about, you know, you mentioned Elliot Rocket shot some of those episodes,
right.
If you listen to the podcast, was on a few months ago. We talked about some of his films with Ty West. So I feel like what's great is this world seems to be getting smaller, which is cool.
It is. I mean, it's really wonderful. You know, you start to get that sense that there is a creative community out there. Mm-hmm. I've been doing this for a little while. And so, you know, one of the things that is very inspiring is, you know, to see the work that your peers do, to see people that you've worked with go on and have other successes. We're all competitive, ambitious people, but, I always come back to that sense of, you know, I'm rooting for everybody. I want everybody to succeed. You know, I want the people that whose work I admire to succeed. You know, the people that I've worked with, I want them to succeed, you know, but however it is possible, you know, you do want to have a sense of community, and support each other, you know, as best you can.
Going back to, Price of Glory, you know, we talked a bit about the approach with actors kind of having these heavy hitters that you're working with now. In terms of the technical side of it, you know, now you've got, like you said, you got all these trucks and cinematography and all this. Like, what was that? What was that experience? Was that equally as daunting, or was that maybe a little easier to deal with than the acting side of it, is kind of working with the technical crew?
It was. I mean, the DP, Afonso Beato, mm-hmm. Brazilian DP, you know, he was a good collaborator. But I guess the trickiest part was the boxing sequences, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and I had some experience from the short film, The Fix.
Yeah.
And so everything was storyboarded. Mm-hmm. You know, everything was storyboarded. The big lesson that I had was that, well, you know, boxing is a kinetic sport.
Yeah.
And so things change, right? So, you know, I think I had a good sense of the general shape of a fight. I knew that there was going to be moments that I really wanted to accentuate. And so, you know, we had either the Steadicam in the right place or we had the techno crane, you know, where it needed to be.
Yeah.
You know, but there was a lot of discovery that was happening on the set because the actors would do things that were a little bit different than what I had planned.
Right.
You know, but yeah, it was daunting. I mean, you know, I used to go to the wrestling matches at the Olympic Auditorium in downtown LA, and we shot at the Olympic Auditorium for Price of Glory.
Okay.
And that was very cool. We also shot at the LA Forum. Mm-hmm. You know, we also shot at the Shrine Auditorium. So these were, you know, big venues where you're dealing with, you know, I think one day we had 500 extras at the LA Forum. And you know, to work on that scale was very, you know, it was ambitious. It was, you know, perhaps everybody else was used to doing it. But for me, it was, you know, it was an exciting and exhilarating thing. You know, to have that big of a canvas to work on was really exciting. You know, but yeah, there's a couple of moments where I had to pinch myself and I go, I can't believe this is happening.
Yeah.
You know, so
when you're, Paul Rodriguez is another person in that movie.
Paul Rodriguez is in it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
When you're, I mean, I'm going to ask a question about these fight scenes real quick. I mean, I know you said you storyboard them. Do you, I mean, when you're covering something like that, where there's so many moving parts,
yeah.
I mean, are you still getting just like a master of the whole thing as like a safety, or is it just
absolutely.
Like, okay.
Yeah. No, I mean, you know, you shoot some masters to give an audience a context.
Yeah.
You know, we had some big establishing shots that we, you know, we put a crowd into it, via visual effects, so we had a couple of those.
And you'll run through the whole like fight choreography.
You know, or you'll run through a phrase of it, okay. Right? Or, you know, you'll do a round.
Okay.
You know, in the case of the boxing, you know, we'll do a round or, you know, or a sequence, you know, and, you know, it starts to have a logic to it.
Yeah.
You go, okay, well, we'll shoot this phrase of the fight and then we'll shoot the corner, you know, the dialogue in the corner, we'll shoot the reactions, you know? And so, you know, you go through and, you know, create, a game plan that makes sense for the work. You know, you're doing the sequences over and over again. And so, you know, you have to be mindful of the actors too, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, sadly, and there was one fight and I won't say which, but, an actor did take a punch. Mm. And so, you know, there's that level of danger where you have to be careful. In that case, we had, the same fight choreographer, Benny the Jet Yerkidis, who did my short film. He also did the fight choreography for Price of Glory.
Awesome.
So I had a good rapport with Benny. And we knew when we wanted the moment to be explosive. We knew when we wanted, you know, the actor to feel defeated. We knew when we wanted the big moment at the end, you know, the big punch, right?
Yeah.
You know, that's, you know, that sets off the celebration in the ring. So, you know, so, I mean, it's all mapped out, you know, it's all mapped out and you shoot it in a way that's logical for, you know, for the work. When we were shooting a lot, of course, you read about how Raging Bull was shot and, you know, and the amount of time that they had for some of the sequence, and you get a little jealous because they had so much time, you know, and, you know, you're trying to shoot your big finale in a day and a half, you know, so it's a different experience, you know.
Yeah. This is probably different from the movies to documentary to television, but on that film in particular, were you very much into the, I guess being very specific with the visual aspect of it, like working with the cinematographer, gaffer on like, did you want things to be lit a very specific way? Or with that being kind of the first feature, were you more into trusting them to kind of do their thing? What was that balance?
I mean, I wasn't so specific. I we would talk in terms of mood, right?
Yeah.
You know, what does this scene feel like? Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't telling them where to put the 10K. I wasn't telling them, you know, I wasn't that specific, but, you know, it was more in terms of, okay, what's the feel of this particular scene? You know, so I will say that I've gotten more specific, you know, in later years. You know, usually now, you know, and I do have, you know, a visual reference book that I refer to. So I want this to feel like this. You know, what can we do to get there? What do you need in terms of resources in order to get there?
Yeah.
So, you know, I've gotten more specific. For Price of Glory, it's more talking in terms of mood and tone and, you know, how can we represent the inner life of the actor with the lighting and the environment.
When you're putting together a lookbook or a reference book, I mean, is that made up of movie stills or just still photography, photos
everything.
You took, just anything?
Yeah. Okay. Anything that is representative of, you know, again, it all comes back to supporting the drama, right? Yeah. So, you know, how do you externally manifest the inner life of the character, you know, and then also you want it to be realistic, right? You know, in the kill floor, you know, we took a lot of liberties, you know, in the meatpacking plant, you know, there was two extremes, right? That I would see in journalistic photographs of those environments. Some were really brightly lit.
Yeah.
You know, or there was a handful of photographs that I'd seen that there was more mood. In the spaces. And so we went in that direction because that was my taste, right?
Yeah.
You know, so we pushed that look, a little bit more mood, more top light.
Right.
You know, so, but I'm that specific. You know, I'm that specific. I had photos that I could talk to Anthony Brooks and I go, this is what I want it to look like.
Yeah.
And Anthony certainly had his point of view. Mm-hmm. He had his, you know, his taste. You know, and we figured it out. We figured out something that that was representative of the world, but that had an expressionistic quality to it as well.
And when you're doing transitioning to television from that, I mean, since I think you said it perfectly, like you're doing the work but in someone else's house.
Yeah.
Are you really just focused on the actors and or are you still kind of dealing a lot with cinematographers and all that? Because it's like, well, I mean, how long does it take to shoot a typical episode? Say like Grimm, for example.
Yeah, you know, I think in both cases, you know, Grimm and Cold Case, those were 8-day shoots. Mm-hmm. And then you get, I think it's 7 days to prep it.
Okay.
You know, so if you're lucky, and in both those cases, I was fortunate in that I was able to have the DP with me when I would visit locations, when I would, you know, I do shot lists and we'll walk the sets together. And so that's a wonderful collaboration. If you, you know, oftentimes, you know, you never know whether the DP is going to be available to you, but in both those shows, there were DPs that were alternating.
Okay.
And so I had Elliot Rocket or I had Ross Berryman or I had, I can't even remember the Cold Case DP, but, you know, so it was great to be able to prep with those DPs and have the, you know, have the benefit of their experience of shooting those sets.
Yeah.
You know, I saw your, Elliot Rocket, episode and you know he's a really experienced guy and you know he talks about you know shooting on those sets that you know have been shot quite a bit and how what can you bring that's new to how do you approach those scenes. And so if you're you know if you have a DP available to you that you can talk to, they can give you ideas. You know, I mean I certainly try to go in with things prepared and, you know, so that you're not starting from scratch when you, on the day of, you know, but, you know, things change, you know, things are different. The actors want to move in a different way. They see it a little bit different, you know, but yes, to your answer, to answer your question, you're dealing with the cinematographer, with the DP, you're dealing with the various departments, You know, you try to bring as much of your vision to it as possible. And you're also, as an episodic director, you're absorbing the priorities of the showrunners, right? Mm-hmm. You know, so you're listening to them and what they want to achieve. And so to bring that point of view, the tone meeting, you know, what they're trying to achieve, what's the important moment?
Right.
And you try to figure out how to support that, because that's what you're there for. You're there to support their vision and try to contribute to it. Try, you know, I guess the common word is to say that you try to elevate what it is that they're trying to achieve. Mm-hmm. And you do that by your instincts, by your creative point of view.
Yeah. Man, it seems like incredibly daunting to me. I did have Scott Paulin on in my first season of the podcast, who I think he was a professor at UCLA for a while, television director, did like Melrose Plays, Beverly Hills 90210. Yeah. I think he was in Castle, like massive career, was in the right stuff and all that. And we talked about, I asked him about, you know, getting into doing television, and he'd mentioned the tone meetings and all that. It just seems kind of crazy to me if you haven't even seen the like a show before. Like if somebody hit me up, just example, like direct White Lotus. I've never seen this before, you know, but now I have to come in and I'm in season whatever in the middle of it, and there's already an arc happening. I mean, like these episodes that you've done, have you watched any of those shows prior to that? Or is it purely off? You just show up and they tell you the tone meeting, here's the goal. And then, it just seems crazy. And like you said, even the actors have their own ideas. They know where it's going. I mean, I don't know.
No, I mean, I was fortunate in that those shows, I was a fan of those shows, you know, and certainly there was a reason why I was being submitted, why I was pursuing those shows is because I felt that I could achieve something that was within the spirit of the show. Mm-hmm. I felt that my sensibilities could align with what they're trying to do creatively in the show. So, you know, I pursued them. In the case of Grimm, the producer-director Norberto Barba, you know, just a veteran, wonderful, you know, just a generous human being, was somebody who I'd gotten to know over the years. And I had shadowed another director on Grimm, and then they offered me an episode. And so, you know, I was a student of Grimm. I knew the show by the time I got there. And I think, you know, absolutely. I haven't done enough of them to say that, you know, I got offered a show that I wasn't aware of, you know, or hadn't been done before. I mean, usually, at least my experience has been, I come in, you know, a few seasons into it. Mm-hmm. So there's a history, a visual history, and a thematic history, you know, things have been established, pretty well established by the time I got there. Mm-hmm. And so I was just working within a framework, a creative framework that I was a fan of. And so I was trying to emulate that, but try to bring something to it as well. You know, I got some nice compliments on the work that I did, you know, particularly that first Grimm episode. You know, it was a serial killer. Well, I think they all were, you know, so, you know, so that was, but they really liked the episode, and therefore they invited me back to do another one.
So, I mean, from here, you've done a documentary, Tales of Masked Men.
Tales of Masked Men, got it.
Yeah. I was like, no, I was just watching it today.
That's right.
I can't forget this.
Yeah.
Lucha Libre, Mexico's unique variation on professional wrestling, has become a distinct aspect of the country's complex cultural identity. This is an exploration of Lucha Libre and a look at three masked wrestlers whose lives and whose own identity were transformed by it.
You're opening up the most wild comic book, and the panels become the ring, the characters come to life, and sit back and enjoy.
So, and that was really interesting to me, because I never seen
really,
like, I mean I know I'm aware of it, but I've never watched the wrestling. I've never been into it. And I know that there's even, I think every year there's like a big luchador thing that happens here.
Yeah, Lucha Vavoom.
People
know that, yeah.
And I feel like, oh, all my friends have gone to this, but I don't even know. So it was really interesting to watch that documentary you made and get this whole history and get into like stories of certain individuals. I mean, what brought on that project for you?
I mean, I've been really blessed in that occasionally I can drift back and do a project that, you know, is very close to the heart, right? Mm-hmm. And so I had the opportunity to pitch a documentary on Lucha Libre to PBS. And clearly they had a similar experience to yours where they had no clue what it was about. And so there was a bit of an education process to it. And there were several points where I didn't think I was going to be able to get it made because, and it, I think it took like 7 or 8 years to get made.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You know, and there was a stretch where I'd given up on it. But it came, you know, when I was 10 years old, I loved it. Mm-hmm. You know, and I grew up in LA, and so the big Lucha Libre venue was the Olympic Auditorium downtown. And so Friday nights, you know, my mom and my stepdad would pack up the cars with kids, drive us down to the Olympic Auditorium, and we would see the matches. You know, and they brought in some of the great luchadores from Mexico. So my big hero was Mil Máscaras and the Man of 1,000 Masks. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he was powerful. He was charismatic. So we would see him in person, but then we'd also see him on TV. And to see a Latino, a Mexicano on TV that was powerful and charismatic and not the sidekick, but the guy who was center stage and that was triumphant and heroic, that meant the world to me. You know, and he, you know, my wife, you know, knows how much that particular wrestler means to me. You know, there's a group of friends of mine, and we all grew up with Mil Máscaras in our lives. And so to be able to, you know, you see how, you know, right or wrong, you know, there is a camp aspect to Lucha Libre. And so I started seeing it parodied a lot. And I said, well, you know, I want to give it some respect. You know, and so that's what set me down that journey to try to tell to do a documentary that gave it a context, that gave it a history as a business, but then also a cultural significance to it, because it's very resonant. I think the Mexican luchadores as iconic, you know, and I'll probably get called out for this, but I think as iconic as the Virgen de Guadalupe. You know, he's just out there everywhere. People see that. You know, he's like the mariachi.
Right, right.
You know, and so it's such a part of Mexican iconography that, you know, I felt, okay, let's try to understand what this world is all about. And in my journey in making it, you know, I got to meet a lot of my heroes. I got to spend like 2 or 3 occasions, I got to spend some time with Mil Máscaras.
Yeah.
And that was, you know, a dream come true, right? Yeah. And I'll give you one of my pictures with him so that you can include
nice,
it. But, you know, then I got to meet some wonderful wrestlers, people that I keep in touch with still. Solar, you know, legendary wrestler. He had a big career in the 70s and 80s, but he's still wrestling well into his 60s. Mascarita Sagrada, you know, a mini wrestler.
Yeah.
So I got to spend time with him. I keep in touch with him. And then we do a historical segment on El Santo, you know, who is the most famous luchador of all time. So, you know, for me to be able to give it a context, you know, it was very joyful for me to, you know, the film was out at film festivals and we won 3 best documentary awards with it. Amazon picked it up for a stretch. Netflix had it distributed internationally. Nice. It's in libraries across the country. It was shown on PBS, I think, 2 or 3 times. So, you know, I sort of feel like I've done my part to give it a context, to give it some respect, You know, people could still have fun with it, you know, and, yeah. and still enjoy sort of that campy side of it. But at least there's something out there now that gives it a historical context.
Yeah. No, it was great. I'm actually really glad that was my first real kind of experience with that. And it's incredible how long these guys' careers go and how long they keep doing it. And
yeah. I mean, Mil Máscaras was wrestling into his 70s.
Yeah, that's nuts.
I mean, it's a different type of wrestling. It's more of an exhibition than competitive, but, you know, but he's still wrestling.
It's all the storytelling, but still having the physicality.
Exactly,
You still have to do these things. And
yeah, it's a poor man theater, too. It has that aspect to it, a morality play.
Right.
Yeah.
And just having that anonymity, too. And it's almost like...
The guys with the masks.
Yeah, and just like this hero aspect to like kids and everything. Like the El Santo whole segment was very interesting to me. And
the number of luchador films that were made. It was a whole genre unto itself.
Yeah.
You know, so it's very, very prominent in Mexican culture. Mm-hmm. And then that's been exported internationally. So, you know, the luchador, like I said, is iconic as mariachi, as the Virgen de Guadalupe.
Yeah, no, definitely. That's for sure. Even for someone like me that didn't know anything about that, like clearly it is iconic. I mean, have you had any ideas or maybe something, some writings in the background somewhere of a feature, like a narrative feature on this topic or?
Honestly, I haven't. You know, I know that there's... I'd read about, you know, two or three different features that had been written with the luchador being a central character. They always seem to get in the development phase and then they peter out. The one that, you know, is kind of the cool one is there's a graphic novel called El Sonámbulo. And that's a cool underground comic that has a main character as a luchador who... I think he fights werewolves at night, you know, and, you know, so he's got this whole other side to him. But I think that's been optioned and they've tried to get that made, but it, you know, they never quite get anywhere. I know that Disney had a series that went 10 episodes that had a luchador character in it. And that was fairly recent, like within the last two or three years.
Yeah.
But unfortunately that, you know, didn't go beyond 10 episodes.
That was the first documentary you've ever done too, right?
Yeah, I mean, I did a short documentary, like a 10-minute documentary for a museum that was just, you know, a gig. And that was, but that was a long time ago, you know. And then to do Tales of Maskmen, that was, you know, like the biggest documentary project that I'd ever done.
How did you start? Was there an outline of, I want to talk about these specific people or... Like a timeline of like, okay, here's the beginning of it. Here's the seven. Like, how did you break it down to even begin the process of shooting it?
Yeah, you know, there's, I guess there's that one school of thought with documentaries. You just go out and shoot and shoot and shoot,
right.
Or you structure it. And, you know, because I had come from a narrative film background, I actually had an outline, you know, of the way that I wanted to approach it.
Yeah.
Because I didn't want it to be one of these endless projects. You know, I have friends who have worked 10 years on documentaries, you know, and I go, I can't do that.
Yeah.
You know, so I did structure it. You know, I did have topics that I wanted to take on to, you know, because it had a historical aspect to it, you know, there's a certain chronology that you follow and then you break up into the individual stories. So it had a pretty firm structure by the time we went out and shot. And then I have, you know, a wonderful editor that I work with named Tom Calderon. Mm. And I've known Tom since film school. And so we've done 8 projects together, and that was one of them. And so Tom helped me shape it quite a bit. To be able to have a strong conception of what you want it to be is going to save you a lot of time.
Yeah.
And that was, I was trying to be as efficient and as economical as possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that it because as it was starting, I was thinking like, okay, I wonder if we're going to follow kind of one person's journey. But I like how it's almost segmented in, you know, Solard, and then you have, I forgot, but the, you know, you get into the segment of the smaller guy.
Yeah.
And then Santo and all these different characters throughout, mixed in with the interviews and everything.
Yeah.
Like, it all like played really well and made sense the way it progressed. Like,
yeah.
I've only tried one. I should send you this. I've done one short documentary so far. And then that one was definitely some freestyle, like let's go out and make it. But I think it worked out well.
Yeah.
Considering it was,
I look forward to seeing you, man.
Yeah, it was helpful. It was with Daniel Villarreal.
Okay, cool.
So we both just kind of collaborated on it. Uh-huh. Like, all right, get in the car and we're just talk about your life and see where you grew up and all that. I'll send it your way.
Yeah, absolutely.
I might post it on the YouTube channel soon. We'll see.
All right. That's but, a little puppet, right?
Yeah, a little puppet.
That's Nethead. Yeah, extended deliver, right? Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, the finger man.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
What was I going to say? Oh, so yeah, great documentary. And
yeah, thanks.
I mean, now, well, let's talk about The Kill Floor a little bit. Your most recent project. I mean, you shot it like probably a year ago, right? Like last summer, maybe last spring?
August 2022.
Okay.
Yeah.
August 2022. Exactly. Right now, you had your premiere maybe a month or two ago.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. It's San Diego Latino Film Festival. Yeah, exactly.
Playing through the festivals now. I was lucky enough to see it because you sent it my way. I almost wanted to go to that festival check it
it's
out.
It's a great festival.
Yeah. I had the work that weekend, but I'm glad I was able to see it.
Yeah.
And I mean, I've been following your progression through Instagram.
That's great.
I think we may have mentioned how, you know, we actually got in contact before you started shooting it.
Yeah.
And I think I said thank you in the email, but I've got to vocalize this. Like, thanks for showing me that pitch deck too. Like, that was just really inspiring for me. And I was like, oh, this is great to see like a professional director, how they kind of break these things down. And so having that as a reference and then watching your film was really just awesome to see kind of how that grew. I mean, do you want to share with us and the listeners like what it's about and why you made it?
I think when the pandemic hit, you know, like everybody else, you know, trying to figure out whether or not we were facing the apocalypse or not, you know, keeping up with the news, one of the stories that caught my eye was the situation that was happening in the meatpacking plants. And I knew that there was a lot of Latinos who were working in the poultry plants in the South. But then I started reading more and more about what was happening in the meatpacking plants. And I was kind of surprised at how many Latinos were working throughout the country in meatpacking plants. And so, you know, they were one of the communities that was impacted the most by COVID hitting a workspace like a meatpacking plant where you're working in close proximity to one another. And the more and more that I read about it, the more moved I was by the situation. For some reason, and maybe it was just the articles that I was reading, but there was story after story about Latinos who were either dying or they were, you know, their communities were affected by, you know, the impact of COVID. There was one story in particular that really got to me. There's a JBS plant in Greeley, Colorado. And there was the story of a gentleman named Saul Sanchez. And he'd been working at that plant for 30 years. And I think he was in his early 70s. And he's still working.
Yeah.
And he was one of the first ones to get COVID in the plant. The plant was very loose about enforcing the protocols, you know. And so, you know, there was quite a outbreak at that plant. And so this gentleman, Saul Sanchez, was one of the first to get it. You know, he was put in isolation, he was put on a ventilator and eventually died. But one of the things he told his family before he passed away was, please tell them at the plant that I'll be back to work soon. You know, once I get over this, I'm going to go back to work.
Yeah.
And, you know, that just really impacted me because it showed, you know, something that we both know about our community is that there's that great work ethic, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so this guy had been at that plant. You know, he'd been able to support his family. He took great pride in being a working man, you know. And the negligence of that plant and putting him in harm's way by not enforcing those protocols and not bringing them into the workspace and essentially putting profit over these people that were working for them, you know, this seemed like there was a crux there for which I could tell a story.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I kept researching, kept reading up on what was happening. One of the other aspects of it, and it's part of the story, was I was very impressed that a lot of Latino journalists were covering the story. And I got a hold of two of them and was able to have conversations with them. There was a young reporter in North Carolina in the Raleigh area, and he had covered what was happening in the poultry plants. And one thing that he told me that I was very impressed by was that the Latino workers, the Spanish speakers, would open up to him because he spoke Spanish. Mm-hmm. And so I thought that was, you know, that he was able to capture that point of view because he had a facility with the language, because they were able to bond with him and open up and tell him about their experiences in the meatpacking plants, in the poultry plants. Mm-hmm. And I try to find a way to weave those things, you know, the older worker storyline and the right. young journalist story who's encountering these people, and to tell a story that reflected those two experiences. You know, I think the story of the pandemic is so huge. You know, we've lost so many people that, you know, sometimes you need to personalize it. You know, it's not enough just to read the journalistic accounts, you right. know, the stuff that's in the newspaper. And so I wanted to tell a narrative film that was set in that world that dealt with some of the themes and the issues that Latino essential workers were facing. And, you know, that's where that came from. You know, I had that impulse. I was moved by the situation. And it seemed like a really important story to tell. I think that, you know, when the story of the pandemic is written, you know, there's, you know, hopefully this isn't a footnote, but maybe because our story exists, the kill floor exists, people remember that a lot of essential workers were impacted, were, you know, sacrificed, you know, at the right. altar of the prophets.
Right, right.
You know, and you know, this was a Latino experience that I think needed to be told. Mm-hmm. And so that's why we did it.
It was great. And watching it, you know, I definitely feel that. It's like, yeah, this is the almost the kind of forgotten people that were yeah. out there doing it through this,
yeah,
whole,
exactly.
this whole ordeal. It's easy to, I mean, everyone takes it for granted just on a regular basis,
yeah.
but to even forget that this is all this food's coming from somewhere right
exactly,
now.
Exactly, absolutely.
You know? And yeah, that take on the work ethic too, and everybody
yeah.
just kind of keeping the heads down and
yeah.
just staying the course.
Yeah.
I mean, that's definitely relatable for a lot of us, for sure.
And there was one story that really got to me. And I wish I knew which state it was in, but there was a meatpacking plant in the Midwest. You know, and to show you how callous, you know, some of these, you know, some of the management was, there was a group of six managers that were taking bets on the number of their workers that would get sick with COVID. Mm. And they had a pool. You know, and so, you know, that certainly wasn't the case. You know, I think there were some meat packing plants that were trying to be responsible,
yeah.
but that these guys, you know, would be so callous as to that's, you know, this is something that, you know, is a joke to them,
right?
You know, and so, you know, those things kind of pissed me off, and
yeah,
I said,
yeah.
you know, okay, well, we're going to tell this story,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
and so, you know, we were fortunate in that Latino Public Broadcasting came on board; they helped us. It wasn't enough, you know, and so, you know, my wife and I, we, you know, we put up the rest of the money, to tell the story because it needed to be out there.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we're very gratified that now that it's out there, people are responding to it. It's winning awards, you know, it's getting seen. And so, you know, hopefully the film will be a witness to the circumstance, to what happened, so that, you know, I think one of the great things that stories can do is they help us to remember. Mm-hmm. And so I want people to remember what happened, you know, and I hope that the kill floor contributes to that.
And when it's, I mean, completed its festival run,
yeah,
I imagine it'll be made public for everybody. Yeah. Like, will it be posted and will the public broadcasting play it? And
yeah, you know, I mean, we're trying to figure it out, but, mm-hmm. You know, and I haven't heard the final word, but it will be streamed eventually on a PBS platform.
Okay.
Latino Public Broadcasting has a series that they do called The Voices, mm-hmm. and they're going to do, I believe, a digital version of it. It won't be broadcast, but it'll be streamed. And so I'm not sure the timing of that, but that's supposed to happen sometime in the fall. And so, you know, nationwide people can see the story.
Yeah,
additionally, and one thing that I've one of the people that have been very helpful to me was the International Food and Commercial Workers Union. And so when I was researching the project, they were very helpful. They gave me some guidance on the script. They snuck me into a meatpacking plant to tour, to tour it so I could get a sense of, you know, of what it looked like. I got to know some of the meatpacking plant workers. Mm. I won't say their names, but they were taking photographs inside the meatpacking plant and they were sending it to me.
Yeah.
So that, and we emulated the attire, mm-hmm. you know, the wardrobe that was used. And additionally, we were able to get Miguel Najera, who plays Agustin, the main character, one of the main characters. Mm-hmm. We snuck him into a meatpacking plant, so he got to tour it and got to see the behavior of the workers, got to see the power dynamics, got to see the process.
Right.
So we're trying to get the word out about the film with the help of the union as well.
Nice.
Yeah.
Did you shoot on location or did you have to kind of create a set for those scenes?
Yeah, I mean, I sort of worked from the premise that no meatpacking plant in the country was going to let me come in and shoot, you know, and then I think also just to have the control needed. So we built our own section of a meatpacking plant, and I think it's pretty convincing. And then with that visual approach of keeping it a little bit darker and moodier, you know, I think we were sort of create that illusion as well.
Very, very cold. It's got that kind of tip bluish tone.
Contrasts exactly.
Well with the like the exteriors of the father and the son.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, and we'll start wrapping this up pretty soon.
Sure.
On the filmmaking side of it, I mean, going from, you know, we've just gone through the career of getting into features and television and everything. Was it very freeing? I mean, I imagine it was tough working within a limited budget, especially since, like you said, you had to complete the funds for it yourself. But was it very freeing or tough to kind of go back to this more independent short film, like very, I'm assuming, kind of bare bones style of filmmaking? Or how did that feel?
It felt very comfortable, mm-hmm. you know, to go back to those independent roots.
Yeah.
To put together a crew that, you know, was in many ways handpicked for the project.
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't coming into a situation that was already a standing army.
Yeah.
And I was able to put the team together. Mm-hmm. So that was great. And then, you know, again, you know, I've had the benefit of having some long-term collaborators. Mm-hmm. The costume designer, Elaine Montalvo, you know, was someone that I'd worked with before. It was nice to work with her again. Mm-hmm. My editor, Tom Calderon, it was great to work with him again. Mm-hmm. Francisco Hernandez, who's our line producer. I'd actually never worked with Francisco before. And, you know, he's had a pretty impressive career as well. But we've known each other for a long time. And so to be able to work with him, you know, so I felt supported. I felt surrounded. you know, and so it was great to go out and know that I had all these people that were lifting me up and believed in the story, believed in its importance, and to be able to go out and just tell it. You know, we shot for, you know, it was fairly quick, you know, 5 days. And then I found this young man in Bakersfield who was a drone hobbyist.
Okay.
You know, not like a tricked out drone operator, you know, for feature films or anything like that. It was just a young guy who was really good at it. And so we have some aerial shots, some drone shots in the film. It was just some guy I saw on YouTube.
Yeah.
You know, Christian Ramirez, and he came through like gangbusters for us.
Awesome.
Yeah. So, you know, it was a little bit of that indie guerrilla style, but within the framework of some people who really knew what they were doing.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think it turned out really well. Like I mentioned, it was great to see it. I look forward to when it's kind of public and there for everybody to
check
out. I mean, what's the next step for it right now? I know you said it's doing kind of festival runs.
It is. Yeah. And so we're trying to build up for to gain its visibility so that by the time it gets a release on a PBS platform, you know, that people are excited about it. Yeah.
Yeah. And you have an Instagram. Is it the Instagram just the kill floor?
The kill floor short film.
Kill floor short
film. Yeah. I'll send it to you so you can put the graphic up.
Yeah. Everybody follow it.
That's right. That's right.
What's next?
So I have a project that's been in my life for a long time. It's a script that I wrote, and one of the cities that means the most to me in the country is San Antonio, Texas. And so, you know, way back when, maybe about 25, 30 years ago, I was there, and I heard about this phenomenon that was happening there where there was a big music scene, rhythm and blues, rock and roll. And there were a lot of Mexican-American bands, a lot of African-American bands. There was a club scene. There were record labels. You know, it was like a mini Motown. You know, it had that kind of vibe to it. And so I had written an ensemble story in the vein of something like Diner, American Graffiti.
Yeah.
You know, that type of story, an ensemble story. And so way back, we were trying to get it made with a producer, and you know, we tried for 2 or 3 years to get it made, and nothing happened. And so last year, when I was in post production on the Kill Floor, that same producer got a hold of me and said, "Let's try and get it made again." So I did a big rewrite on the script. It's called Last Band Standing. Yeah. And so we're trying to get that made. And again, it's a rock and roll picture. It's very cool ensemble story. And hopefully we can shoot it sometime soon.
Yeah. Awesome. And that's feature film or short film?
Feature film.
Awesome. I'm looking script. Forward to that. Yeah.
Yeah.
I hope that comes
absolutely.
Through.
Yeah. Thank you.
How long does it, I mean, I know you said it's been a few years already, but from this
long
point,
time.
Like, yeah, it could decades. Take any amount of time.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, you know, this producer, world-class producer, is very optimistic.
Cool.
So we'll see. We'll see what happens. But, you know, I'm prepping for it.
Yeah.
You know, doing a soft prep. Optimistic that it'll get made.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's great, man. Where can everybody find you and check out Kill Floor once it's out, and any of your other projects that might be, you know, live and out there?
Well, the episodic stuff is, of course, online. You know, I think Peacock has Grimm, and HBO Max has the Cold Case. I believe that on Amazon you can still find Price of Glory, you know, and not at a discounted price. You know, so you still have to pay some money for it.
Yeah.
Hopefully that'll end up on HBO Max. That would be wonderful eventually. And then, you know, look for the Kill Floor. You know, if you follow me on Instagram, I'll certainly announce it. And we'll put, I believe my Instagram handle is Carlos Avila _pics.
Yeah.
And so you can follow me there, and yeah, I'll certainly announce it there.
Yeah. Well, great, man. Thanks so much for spending time and coming
Absolutely,
out here.
Absolutely, my pleasure. Thank you for the paloma. It's now all gone.
Yeah. Oh, you want to try a little bit of this?
I would. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I'll
pour you a bit real quick.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, this is a good one right here. Maybe a little taster. You good right there. You want more? I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's great. And I see the engraving on the
drinks in a movie glasses.
That's awesome, man. That's great. A little more.
I'll probably drink a lot of this while I pack up. It's going to be a while, but just kidding. Mezcal 32.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you.
Fart.
Yeah. Thanks for your persistence.
Yeah. Thanks for coming out.
Thank you for listening to the Drinks in a Movie podcast. You can now find us on Instagram at Drinks in a Movie Pod, where we'll be posting photos from all the various films that we discuss. You can also email us at drinksinamoviepod@gmail.com. Please rate, review, and subscribe, and thank you for listening.